emergencies can and do occur in dental environment. Before we start this video, I want you guys to take a look at some of the studies done on this topic. Friends, do you know that why in the most of the dental clinics we don't have anything such as emergency kit? Because it's a common human nature, okay? It's a common human psychology that nothing wrong will happen with me, okay? That is an inner belief which we all carry, and because of that belief, we don't act on it, right? We already believe that, nahi, aisa nahi hoga. That will not happen with me, right? But being a health professional, it is our noble duty to stay prepared for such emergency situations, right? So I urge you all to take this lecture very seriously and understand all the medications and the route through which we have to give it very sincerely. We should be prepared to recognize and manage the medical emergencies which are occurring in dental environment. Medical emergencies were most likely to occur during and after local anesthesia, extraction or endodontic procedures. And among all the medical emergencies which can occur in dental environment, 60% of which is syncope. And other medical emergencies which can occur in dental practice are foreign body aspiration, hypoglycemic attack, seizures, and hyperventilation. What can we do to prevent medical emergencies before occurring, right? We can take thorough medical history. When we all were students, when we were in college, we used to take thorough medical history, right? Because the pressure of our professors, because the pressure of our teachers, right? But as we come into private practice, somewhere we neglect these things. We don't take it that much seriously. But yes, thorough medical history can save us from a very ugly situation, right? In addition to that, we should maintain an emergency drug kit and some few equipments for the emergency situations, right? So what are those emergency drugs which we can keep in our clinic? That is what we are going to talk in this video. So all the emergency drugs are basically classified into two parts: the essential emergency drugs which we have to have, okay, and we should have thorough and sound knowledge about those drugs, and the other group of emergency drugs are supplemental drugs. Now before we talk about the situations and the drugs which can be used in it, we should be clear with two things about it. First of all, you have to keep your emergency kit which is freely accessible to everybody. Even in your absence, your assistant or any consultant doctor should be able to reach those drugs, okay? Second thing, it should be placed at a constant place. Do not change its position, right? We all know that the basic protocols for emergency management are PABC, which stands for position, airway, breathing and circulation. So in any emergency situation, whether in dental clinic or outside of the dental clinic, being a health professional, being a doctor, it is our duty to save somebody's life, okay? And if we have got that chance, we should not be just standing here and thinking that what should I do. We should be knowing it, that what should be our next steps. Now talking about the emergency drugs which we should be keep in our dental clinic, there are six, okay? Among which first is oxygen. Oxygen is the most important emergency drug, okay? Although we find it very rarely in dental setup, still we are going to talk about oxygen because knowledge is power, you know? It should be there in your knowledge. Oxygen is indicated in all emergency medical situations except hyperventilation. Now what happens in hyperventilation? In hyperventilation, we inhale less and exhale more, okay? So that condition is hyperventilation. In such situation, we are not supposed to give oxygen. Otherwise, in all conditions, we can give oxygen. And before starting with oxygen therapy, you have to ensure airway, okay? Airway should be patent, and there are two methods through which we can set a patent airway. One is head tilt and chin lift procedure, and the second is jaw thrust procedure. My friends, we all should be thoroughly knowing this, okay? Because we don't know that where we can anticipate any accident or not. Oxygen can be given by two ways, via face mask, okay, and the flow rate should be 10 liters per minute. And the second way is through ventilators, okay. In the image you can see the mechanical ventilator over there. Now the second essential drug is adrenaline, okay. If a patient gets allergic reaction, which we call it anaphylactic shock, okay, due to the any material or due to local anesthesia, then what we have to give? We have to give adrenaline. As you can see in the picture, what happens in anaphylaxis, there is a severe skin reaction, okay? Rashes starts appearing on the skin, and the anaphylactic reaction could vary from mild to severe, okay? It depends upon the person and how allergic that person is to that particular thing. And it could manifest into cardiovascular system, respiratory system, and it might involve whole body also, okay? So how we will manage it? Adrenaline we can give intramuscularly or intravenously, okay? Intramuscularly, what would be the concentration? 1:1000, okay? And for the intravenous route, the concentration is 1:10,000. But let me know you guys that anaphylaxis can occur in two phases, okay? It could be biphasic, or there can be a relapse, which means that you give adrenaline to the patient in your dental office and he is fine. After he went home, after 6-8 hours, again the symptom starts appearing, okay? So to prevent it, we have to give antihistamines as well. And the drug which we will give is chlorpheniramine, okay? Chlorpheniramine we can give orally 4 mg every 4 to 6 hours, okay, which means not more than 24 mg per day, right? And talking about adrenaline, we should also keep in mind that how much adrenaline should be given at what age, okay? 0.5 to 1 mg per ml is given for adults. And about the pregnant women, we have to be very cautious in giving adrenaline because it decreases the vascular supply to placenta. And what adrenaline does is, adrenaline will increase the heart rate by acting on the myocardium, and it will also increase the blood pressure, right? That's why we use it as first line drug for acute anaphylactic reactions and acute asthmatic attacks also, we can give adrenaline, okay? Now the third drug is antihistamines. As I said little about chlorpheniramine and diphenhydramine, okay? Both these drugs should be available to us as they are used for definitive management of acute allergic reactions, okay? After giving adrenaline, we have to give antihistamines for its definitive treatment. And apart from that, patients who have known allergy to local anesthesia, we can give diphenhydramine as local anesthetic as well, okay? Now the fourth drug is salbutamol. In the acute asthmatic condition, the first line drug which is used is salbutamol, okay? It is available in the inhaler form. It is quite a dangerous situation, but as you already have that knowledge, you have to anticipate the situation by giving salbutamol via inhalation, right? What salbutamol does is it releases the bronchospasm. They are bronchodilators. They are beta agonist, right? The drug which we have is aspirin. It is newly added drug in the list of emergency situation, okay? So where we can use aspirin in case of acute myocardial infarction cases, okay? When a patient feels the heart attack or myocardial infarction, the pain is very much severe, and in this condition we have to give aspirin. and the dosage would be 162 milligram according to some books, and according to some books it is ranging from 150 to 300 milligram dosage. Okay, it will also act as antiplatelet drug, right? So it would be a life-saving drug in case of myocardial infarction. Aspirin we said about myocardial infarction, but what about angina? What is the difference between angina and myocardial infarction? Angina is basically a discomfort in the heart. Okay, how patient will express it is there would be a mild pain in the left side of the chest and it might radiate to the left arm or the left jaw. Okay, so that is the typical sign of angina. And why does it occur? There is an imbalance between the myocardial oxygen demand and supply. So because of this imbalance, there is a pain which is generating, which is mild initially, but it can progress it. Okay, so how will you anticipate the condition of angina? You have to give nitroglycerin tablets sublingually. The dose would be 0.4 to 0.6 milligram, and the effect of this drug is very short. So you have to repeat the dose every 20 to 30 minutes. Okay, but please keep in mind that if the condition persists even after giving nitroglycerin, the patient has no relief from pain for 10 minutes, then you have to be sure that this is not the angina, this is myocardial infarction. Nitroglycerin, what does it do? It just relaxes the coronary blood vessels. Okay, its function is vasodilatory on our coronary blood vessels. Guys, we often anticipate patients who are very much anxious, okay? They are already so much stressful as the procedure is begun because of the anxiety and fear. The vagus nerve is stimulated, and what does vagus do? It decreases the SA node impulses, okay? Basically, the heart activities decreases. A condition called as bradycardia occurs. So in such situation, what we have to give? Atropine. Atropine is the first line drug for bradycardia, and the dosage is 0.5 milligram per ml intravenously. We should also have aromatic ammonia with us. Okay, why? Because it is a respiratory stimulant. It immediately stimulates the vasomotor center in our medulla and it stimulates the respiration. It is available in the form of vaporols. We have to just put it inside the nostril of the patient. So the patient breathes in, along with that it breathes ammonia, and it stimulates the respiration in the patient. Now for the anti-hypoglycemic agents, you will say that we can give glucose or a fruit drink, right? Yes, you can give that if the patient is conscious and in hypoglycemic state. But if the patient is unconscious, then you should not give oral glucose for the risk of pulmonary aspiration. Okay, in such cases we can give glucagon or 50% dextrose intramuscularly in deltoid or gluteal areas. For adult, the dosage is 1 milligram. Glucose can be given via two ways, okay, orally as we commonly give, and intravenously. If we give intravenously, then it is the fastest route and the symptoms of hypoglycemia can be corrected more readily. So guys, it's so easy to save somebody's life when we have the correct knowledge, right? Knowledge gives us courage to do things, okay? And we can save somebody's life. We can save an emergency critical medical situation just by following few steps, right? If you have made so far into the video, I can say that you have a bright future as a doctor. And the last drug which we are going to study is about corticosteroids. Steroids are mainly given to those patients who are having acute adrenal insufficiency, which means that for the therapeutic use, patient is taking steroid for longer duration. Okay, so as patient is taking steroid for longer duration, his or her adrenal cortex has gone into atrophy. So when the actual stressful situation comes, patient's body cannot combat it. So that we have to give corticosteroids in advance before any stressful situation like extraction, any surgical procedure which we begin. Before that, we have to give a dose of hydrocortisone or dexamethasone. Okay, and the another use of steroids in dental practice is patient of thyroid stone. Okay, and sometimes also for the acute allergic reactions we give steroids. So I hope this video was very helpful to you all and it was informative. Still, if you have any queries, please write to me on Instagram or Facebook, or you can also comment below. And a small request for you all, that please do share it with your friends and your colleagues, because this is the information which everybody should know. Okay, it should be very sound and thorough with us that how to anticipate any medical emergencies in dental practice. See you till the next time.